Good morning. I am Bob Nuxall. Betty Nuxall and I are serving as worship assistants for the service. On behalf of our fellow members and ministers of our congregation, it is my pleasure to welcome you today to the Unitarian Universalist congregation at Shelter Rock. As a Unitarian Universalist, we believe that the Spirit of Life, called by many names, is known to each of us uniquely. As people of the Unitarian Universalist tradition, our task is to encourage one another in our individual transformations. If you are a newcomer here, or are visiting, know that we are glad to have you here. If you would like more information about this congregation or about Unitarian Universalism, we invite you to complete one of the blue visitor cards in the slots at the end of your pew. In the rear of the worship room, there are hearing assist devices. Feel free to seek them out. Immediately after our service, we will reconvene in the social hall just across the lobby for our UU Cafe, where lunch can be purchased at a modest price. If you are a first-time visitor, stop at the welcome desk and get our yellow guest coupon, granting you a free lunch. Before our service, I have a few announcements to share with you. As I do, please take this time to turn off cell phones and other electronic devices. Please. In our order of service, you will find a calendar and many announcements of activities and programs. Note especially that cabaret rehearsals start on this coming Wednesday. Registration is now open for our religious education program. Next week is our religious ed weekend for our RE volunteers. See your order of service for details. Next Sunday's service will feature guest speaker Helen Boxwell's sermon, When Our Heart is in a Holy Place. Following the service, Experience the Wonders of Ethiopia will be presented in the art gallery. 2 weeks from today is our homecoming picnic. Richard Bach needs volunteers for that event. If you have any questions, call our office during the week, but not on Monday. It will be closed on Labor Day. It is now my honor and pleasure to welcome our guest minister, the Reverend Dr. Ken Reeves. He is not only a graduate of Starr King for the ministry, but holds a doctorate in clinical psychology and a master's in pastoral counseling. And, I am told, has a family connection with someone in this very congregation. Please welcome the Reverend Dr. Ken Reeves. Now, let us greet or introduce ourselves to our neighbors.
Thanks, Bob. Nice introduction. Am I right about that? There's my mom. Welcome.
May peace be in your hearts. Through the energy of freedom and the warmth of love, may you live the fullness of being alive, and in that fullness find peace. Through justice and understanding, may humanity be at peace, and may all of life on earth live together in balance and peace. Well, good morning. It's good to be with you all. This is getting to be a regular thing. About every year around Labor Day, I get a call, can you come down and be a guest preacher? And I go, of course, I'd love to. And I come down from Massachusetts and I visit my mom, and here I am. I love being with you this time. I appreciated Bob's welcome to anyone visiting for the first time. If I could add my own welcome. I think it takes some courage to enter the doors of an unfamiliar congregation. So I applaud your courage and extend my welcome. And if I were to add an introduction of this congregation to our visitors, I would add that, like other Unitarian Universalist congregations, this is a support community for people on various journeys towards ultimate goals, such as love, or peace, or union. We support each other in many ways. I think one of the ways that we support each other is by kind of clearing the path on the journey, not adding obstacles to it. And you can see this attitude reflected in one of our earliest Universalist forebears, John Murray, who said, give them not hell, but hope and courage. We clear the obstacle of fear and give people hope and courage. I think this attitude is also reflected in our purposes and principles, one of which affirms the inherent worth and dignity of every person. And believing in one's worth is freeing. Shame and guilt are inhibiting. So I think to believe in one's worth, to be freed on the journey, is one of the things we do to support each other on our journeys. And that's what, in a way, today's service is about. It's about sort of the journey of life, the journey of human life, and the journey towards cooperation. I offer this service out of my caring for you and my desire to support you on your journeys. I hope that as you journey, you find love and freedom and live the full richness of being alive.
Please stand as you are able and join in the singing of hymn number 128, For All That Is Our Life, number 128 in the gray hymnal. Thank you. Please remain standing for our words and song of affirmation printed in your order of service. Love is the doctrine of this congregation. The quest for truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge and freedom, to serve human need, this do we affirm and covenant with each other.
Storm, hold your head up. If you are grateful for the presence of Unitarian Universalism in this world and for this congregation, become its advocate. If you are concerned for the future of our faith, share our message. If our principles resonate deep within you, give to this religious tradition your devotion. Our tradition of Unitarian Universalism cannot survive without your devotion and your generosity. Would the ushers please come forward to accept this morning's offering?
My reading this morning is, a generous expression of a willingness to cooperate. It's a familiar reading, the prayer of St. Francis. The truth and advertising department of this congregation, though, asked me to tell you that this prayer was probably not written by St. Francis. And it first occurred around 1912, about 700 years after St. Francis had lived. So it might be considered the prayer in the spirit of St. Francis. Nevertheless, here we are.
The prayer of Saint Francis.
Lord, make me an instrument of your peace.
Where there is hatred, let me bring love.
Where there is offense, let me bring pardon.
Where there is discord, let me bring union.
Where there is error, let me bring truth.
Where there is doubt, let me bring faith.
Where there is despair, let me bring hope.
Where there is darkness, let me bring light.
Where there is sadness, let me bring joy.
O Master, let me not so much seek to be consoled as to console.
To be understood as to understand.
To be loved as to love.
For it is in giving that we receive.
It is self-forgetting that one finds.
It is in pardoning that one is pardoned.
It is in dying that one is raised to eternal life. I invite any who would like to light candles of joy or sorrow to come forward now in the quiet of this moment. May I caution you not to reach over a flame to either light or place a candle. Thank you.
spirit of love in this complicated life when relationships can be difficult, when people can be confusing. Support us as we cooperate with each other. Guide us as we love each other. Give us your sense of union with one another that allows us to create bridges and reach across spans to connect and love. Amen. Thank you, Leah. Thank you, Nathaniel. Like I said, it's good to be back in this church where I grew up. I enjoy seeing you all, and I get to reminisce. Looking back, unfortunately, I was a grumpy, alienated youth. I was lost and confused. But I began to find a direction. I observed our minister at the time, Harold Hadley, talk about ideas. I did not understand all that he said, but I was intrigued. I read history and observed ideas influencing the course of humanity. I read Thoreau and felt stirred by his ideas. I realized I liked ideas. I decided I wanted to explore and understand ideas. Here I also found people caring about people, and being cared about, caring for others, felt good. I realized I wanted to join the caring. Merging caring with ideas, I decided I wanted to offer constructive ideas as a way to care about people and improve lives. That became my life's purpose. With a purpose, I grew up. It's great to have a purpose. Purpose explains why we bother doing what we're doing. It motivates, it makes life meaningful. When life throws its inevitable challenges and losses, purpose keeps you going. It even extends your lifespan. Purpose gives you a why, and with a why, a how follows. So I know what I'm here to do. I'm no longer alienated and grumpy, usually. I keep plugging along. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Thank you, church. Purpose has three components: identity, what one is, who one is, mission, what one is here to do, and vision, where one is going. My identity, someone who likes ideas and cares about people. My mission, to understand and express ideas. My vision, to improve lives. I imagine each of you has a purpose, an identity, a mission, and vision based on what has resonated within you. And purpose goes larger to life on earth. I think life has a purpose, and it's not grumpy and alienated as a result. The purpose of life seems to be to extend its vitality into every opportunity the earth, sun, water, and air allow. Into shallow oceans, into deep oceans, forests, meadows, my backyard, my front yard. In fact, everywhere, resulting in complex and varied species, hummingbirds, orchids, whales, and in my yard, multifarious weeds. This complexity began when atoms formed increasingly large and complex molecules, and then those molecules became not just complex, but alive. Living molecules grew into cells, then into organisms. First, life reproduced by cloning, then by two individuals working together, as in sex. Animals went from living solitarily into forming groups, and along with complexity came more than interaction and cooperation. Indeed, organs working together in a body, sexual reproduction, and living in groups all require some cooperation. I don't know why nature strives for increasing complexity, variety, and cooperation. I mean, why not just let the earth be a lifeless rock with some sterile water? Though I don't know why, I have an idea about how. The urge to form life is supported by the carbon atom, which is well designed for bonding with other atoms and bonding with other carbon atoms, making it ripe for forming complex molecules that tip into becoming alive. Carbon is like the hostess of a party. Everyone knows her, she's fun and bubbly, people gather around her, and when the party becomes alive, the joint is really jumping. Carbon plus liquid water in which molecules can float, plus energy from the sun, and bam, life begins and continues down the path of complexity, variety, and cooperation. Beavers, for example, add to life's complexity and variety. They find a creek that would support some trout and a few frogs and change that moving water into a pond that supports other species of fish, more frogs, plus ducks, cattails, muskrats, herons, moose, those dam builders increase the variety of life a creek can sustain. And that's their purpose, to help life be complex and varied. The most recent complexity to involve is the human brain. Our brains have 100 trillion neural connections. It's more connections than stars in the Milky Way. Our brains might be the most complicated structures in the universe. Evolution handed humans big brains, not to handle the simple tasks of hunting and gathering, but to manage the more complicated tasks of cooperating and collaborating with each other. That takes a lot of brain power. And indeed, we are more cooperative than our cousins, the apes. Chimpanzees forage in groups and form alliances, but do not work together as a team. They find a banana plant, and everybody grabs what they can and separates to eat. They spot a stray chimp from another clan and attack, but not in a coordinated assault, just a melee. While a group of apes is a collection of individuals, evolution called humans to coalesce into teams. Maybe the apes outforaged the early humans, so one day someone's 100 trillion neural connections had an idea, expressed using language at a meeting. Those darn monkeys are hogging the fruits and berries, but what if we shift from foraging together to spreading our search wider and then collecting and sharing what we find? Apes, on the other hand, have few, if any, new ideas, small vocabularies, do not work as a team, do not have meetings, and do not make decisions that affect the group. Indeed, our knockdown, drag-out meetings make us human. You're now all looking forward to your next meeting. Early humans also hunted small animals like rabbits, and the benefit of such a kill are small. They scavenged already killed larger animals, maybe chasing off the lions that had done the deed. But after shooing off lions and eating whatever scraps remained, someone might have had an idea, offered at another meeting. How about if we kill a big animal ourselves? Lacking fangs or claws, humans can only hunt successfully by working together as a team. So they did. To work as a team, we do what apes cannot. We guess what someone else is thinking and intending to do. Even having whites in our eyes allows us to see what someone else is looking at and anticipate their action. So if I'm a primal hunter and I see my fellow hunter's eyes focused on that mastodon, I think he must see a way to strike. And then to support the future I want, stakes for the clan. Unlike an ape, I control myself, manage my nerves, don't startle that mastodon, and prepare to follow with a strike of my own for the good of the team. Our human identity, then, is to be a big brain species that cooperates and collaborates. Of course, we do not always cooperate. I mean, warring against each other, pillaging the planet. I think we are the most destructive species on Earth. After 9/11, President Bush declared a war on terror, which is estimated to have cost thousands of lives and $6 trillion. A $6 trillion tab for violence has not raised many eyebrows. It's normal. Or one particularly sad example of destruction. In 1907, a bird collector named Allenson Bryan shot, killed, and drove into extinction the last of a species of birds called black mammoths, and felt then joy. Enjoying destruction seems normal. Maybe it is our identity to be a Jekyll and Hyde species, the zenith of cooperation alongside ruthless destruction. On the other hand, maybe our destructiveness is not embedded in our identity, but a side effect or something we can outgrow. As a side effect, maybe our brain power corrupts. Power does corrupt. Add to that power the use of tools, from fire to nuclear fission, and corrupted by power, we wreak havoc. If so, we need checks on our power. Laws, for instance, restrain my power to act destructively. I mean, my car can travel at 60 miles per hour, but laws check my power to go that fast in my neighborhood street. Checks and balances restrain power in our branches of government. Democracy checks the power of a would-be autocrat. So there could be checks on this power. Or maybe people are destructive because it is difficult to cooperate. You have to marshal those 100 trillion synapses. You have to attend meetings, express your ideas, listen to someone's differing ideas, blah, blah, blah. It's easier to go ape and refuse to cooperate. What helps people rise to the challenge of cooperation is maturity. According to Freud, during childhood, one learns that the world will not give in to all one's demands. Instead, one has to give a little to get a little. Eat the vegetables before the ice cream. Cooperate with the family, then the playground. A day's work before the paycheck. We can mature further. Or we're destructive because, like many species, we organize ourselves into a hierarchy. And when competing to be up, we stomp on those below. Rich against poor, men against women, people against nature. What offsets the hierarchy is equality and the democratic idea that we're all in this together. Our country was founded with this idea that we were created equal. Unfortunately, equality and democracy are still new ideas in the whole of human history. I think we spent more time in caste systems and with God ordaining kings. We're still trying democracy and equality on for size. With time and practice, we can get used to these ideas. Or we're destructive because we are reactive to threats that are not really threatening. When we react and swing to the fight or flight response, our cooperative brain goes offline, our most primitive brain emerges, we cry havoc and let slip the dogs of war. Sometimes we do need to react to a threat, but other times we're safer than we think. For instance, the other day I was out bicycling, turning at a T intersection. I was a little late to see a motorist going straight who had to slow to let me pass in front. The motorist then cursed me out, like I had intentionally totaled his SUV. He was protected by 4,000 pounds of steel, and I by a few ounces of polyester and spandex. I believe I was less a threat than he thought. What moderates reactivity is security. Growing up in a secure environment allows a child to develop one's prefrontal cortex, which is good at discerning a threat from a non-threat and guiding moderate action, such as, oh brother, another maniac cyclist who should ride more cautiously. Or finally, maybe we're destructive because we're not used to being an apex species. It took wolves and sharks millions of years to evolve into apex species, where the wolf loping through a meadow, the shark gliding through the sea, they have become pretty secure. They kill to eat, but do not wreak havoc. Humans vaulted into our apex status over a mere few hundred thousand years. And being new, our apex status is vulnerable, and so we overdo it. We're like Macbeth, suddenly king and killing madly to stay king. We're like bullies, secretly insecure and anxious,
and needing to be extra aggressive out of a fear of losing our status and going back to gnawing on some antelope the lions have killed. I think indeed we demonize species like wolves and sharks, unconsciously envying their security. If so, in time, we will become used to our status, feel secure, and give up bullying, and let our cooperation shine through. This is already happening. Through human history, we have gone from being so aggressive that 1 in 7 primal people died by violence, and today it's 1 in 7,000. Still too many, but the bullying has declined. I saw a fun example of this last summer in Fiji. I visited Fiji. And just 200 years ago, Fijian villages would wage war on each other, and defeated prisoners would become the chief's next meal. Their development and some courageous missionary work result in today not only no cannibalism, but amazing friendliness. Everywhere you hear the boisterous national greeting, Bula! And friends greet each other with hilarity as if to say, Bula! I have not seen you since yesterday, my friend, and it cracks me up to see you now. Plus, I know I won't be tomorrow's lunch. And they shake hands and laugh. Hopefully, this is where humanity is heading. More security, less bullying, more fun. And so I see us as a quintessentially cooperative species, but that is corrupted by power, that can opt out of the challenge of cooperating, that creates uncooperative hierarchies, that exaggerates threats, and that bullies to hide insecurity. Unfortunately, there are structural and developmental remedies. Laws, checks and balances, and democracy, maturity, equality, the ability to perceive threats accurately, and increase security as an apex species. And with these remedies, our destructiveness has eased and can ease further, while cooperation, our identity, can continue to emerge. Spiritual experience also supports cooperation. In a spiritual experience, you might have had one in which you experienced the oneness of things. For a moment, the oneness of things. And at one with our brothers and sisters and the entire world, people care about these lives and treat them kindly. Maybe what makes a spiritual experience so rich and meaningful is that it fits our cooperative identity and supports its development. But all this is the long game. I want cooperation now. If a genie offered me 3 wishes, I'd say, I want everyone in the world to be kind and cooperative. The genie would shrug and look down and say, well, that's out of my range, boss. I could make you the richest person in the world, but curing humanity of its destructiveness overnight, even God is working on that, and it takes time. So I'd say, well, genie, how about making me kind and cooperative? Well, nice idea, boss, but God and I together, we have made progress since your grumpy days, but we're not miracle workers. How about if I just create for you your own tropical island with beaches, palm trees, and coral reefs? It could be part of Fiji, and their friendliness will rub off on you. Or just keep going to church and join the caring you find there. I say, okay, well, thanks, genie. I guess growth is slow. So our identity. We are the world's big-brained cooperative species with an asterisk. We can slip into ruthless destructiveness. Our mission is to cooperate. Fijians, and I suspect all of you, have assumed this mission. And there seems to be a tension in the world then between cooperation and non-cooperation. And when I read the news, I wonder, is this event showing humanity cooperating or resisting cooperation? Regrettably, I see some in politics taking a stand against cooperation. It's so complex, and all those tedious meetings. Some voters see this and appreciate the simplicity of non-cooperation. And further, they feel hurt by others and vote for an aggressive champion who will not cooperate but fight back. And observing this tension between cooperation and non-cooperation calls me to keep cooperating. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. If cooperation is our identity and mission, and our mission is to cooperate, our vision is where we are going with our cooperation. And my vision is that we be a friendly, peaceful species in which we say, Bula, to all of our brothers and sisters. And I am not alone with this vision. Because enough people want it, the world is becoming more peaceful and friendly, like Fiji. After that, visions can get more particular. We can cooperate by lifting our brothers and sisters out of poverty. This vision is occurring. Support for education and health, small business and trade have resulted in the world going from 36% of us extremely poor in 1990 to 10% in 2015. We can support children. Indeed, parenting has grown more sophisticated. My parents had Dr. Spock. Now parents have entire bookcases, journals, and psychologists for guidance. We can still progress in making childhood safe and secure. We can extend cooperation to nature. We're making progress here too. I have a dictionary published in 1947 that does not contain the word environmentalist. Now, that is a field of study, the profession of many, and the interest of millions. Now in the U.S., it is illegal to kill a member of an endangered species. And instead of taking joy at an extinction, projects like Hawaii's Snail Extinction Prevention Program work to save threatened animals. With nature in peril, I envision humanity being a big-brained species that understands and cooperates with nature's interdependent balance. In my vision, a president steps up and declares a wish to preserve life on Earth, and people say, great, we are all in, sign us up. And if some president proposes to wage a war, people will say, yeah, well, how are you going to pay for that? You likely have your particular way to display and extend cooperation. Maybe by playing fair, saying please, or being married. I think we are a team collaborating in our own ways to move humanity's dial toward cooperation. So the human purpose, as I see it, is to be the species that uses our 100 trillion neural connections to cooperate and collaborate. I offer this purpose idea out of my caring and hope that with a purpose, humanity would know what we are here to do, and knowing we are here to cooperate, live out and into that cooperative purpose and find it meaningful. I see us growing into this purpose through our history. I see communities such as this one contributing. I see this slow growth supported by the Spirit, which says yes to cooperation by gracing us with miraculous moments of union with all. Well, I'd like to close with this hymn, Love Will Guide Us. It's an expression of cooperation and love guiding us and influencing humanity over the course of history. It's number 131. I want to thank Leah and Nathaniel and Bob and Betty for sharing with me the service, and thank you all for sharing the service with me as well. I hope that you find a grounding in our cooperative identity, and in that grounding find peace and meaning. May we all go in peace. Amen. Sorry.